exit roll at Yorkshire Cricket Club following allegations of racism. The chairman resigns. Others are under pressure over the racial harassment of former player Azeem Rafiq. Also this lunchtime, the 15-year-old boy killed by other teenagers, one as young as 14, in a pre-planned attack. A day of youth protest at the climate summit. Greta is due to join them in Glasgow. A true original from the early days of the Royal Variety performance, Lionel Blair has died. And... was it worth it? ABBA's big comeback, but who is thankful for the music 40 years after their last album?
This is the ITV Lunchtime News with Chris Shipp.
Hello, good afternoon. In a letter accusing his now former cricket club of a culture that refuses to accept change, the chairman of Yorkshire resigned today over the way the club has responded to the racism allegations made against it. But Roger Hutton is not going quietly, accusing the management board at the club of being unwilling to apologise and deal with the claims. Azeem Rafiq, who played for Yorkshire in two stints, has said he suffered racism and bullying there. A senior MP said he knows that of other players who claimed they experienced similar racism at Yorkshire. Carrie Davis has today's developments.
This is a club in crisis, accused of hiding racism and dismissing abuse. Yorkshire County Cricket Club is losing sponsors, international matches and its reputation. Chairman Roger Hutton has resigned and in a statement suggests he recognised the seriousness of the allegations Azeem Rafiq made, but that others refused to do so. He apologises and says, "I'm sorry that we could not persuade executive members of the board to recognise the gravity of the situation and show care and contrition. During my time as chairman, I take responsibility for failing to persuade them to take appropriate and timely." Azeem Rafiq is still waiting for a resolution. An investigation found he was a victim of racial harassment and bullying, but the club said they would take no disciplinary action. The journalist who first published the story 14 months ago says Azeem had been facing this alone.
Azeem had many, many isolated, lonely months where it didn't look like he was winning, and he could have done with a bit of support that's forthcoming now. All I would say is that I hope that Gary Balance and Michael Vaughan and whoever else are named in this report, and lots of people will be, I genuinely hope they receive support and help. I really do.
Despite being named in the report, former England cricket captain Michael Vaughan strongly denies allegations of racism and says, "I know that in my life I've never said anything racist to anybody, so that's what I stand by." Meanwhile, Yorkshire cricketer Gary Balance has apologised for using a racist slur. Others in the sport believe this isn't an isolated case. This cricket shop owner from Bradford says there's a county-wide problem.
I've experienced it myself with my own lads who represented the county junior level. This about making sure that there's not too many Asians in a county setup in the pathways, it's happened for many, many years.
Those in charge at this club will be questioned by a cross-party group of MPs on the 16th. Today, they're gathering to decide where Yorkshire cricket goes from here. Carrie Davis, ITV News.
OK, let's go to Hellidingley then and the Yorkshire County Cricket Ground where we can find Ben Chapman. That urgent meeting is taking place, Ben. So what more can you tell us about what's happening there?
Well, what we don't know is how many board members will be left by the time that meeting takes place at 2 o'clock. We understand from the now former chairman, Roger Hutton, that other non-executive directors have also resigned. Now, in response to his criticisms, the club issued a brief statement this morning thanking him for his work and will have more to say later in the day. The club lost two more sponsors this morning, namely the shirt sponsor NIC Services Group and also its footwear supplier Painter. But there are questions too this lunchtime for the governing body, the England and Wales Cricket Board, because Roger Hutton also made some criticisms of it. He said that it had declined to help when Azeem Rafiq's allegations were first made, and he says he's been continually frustrated at the ECB's reluctance to act. Now, in response, the ECB says that it must act independently of club investigations in case it needs at some stage to step in as a regulator. But what's clear is that this is a row that is escalating well beyond the gates of this ground.
OK, Ben, at Headingley Stadium, thank you very much. A judge has said that four teenagers will receive life sentences for murdering another teenager. Keon Lincoln was killed in a pre-planned attack in January this year. A fifth defendant was also today cleared of murder but found guilty of manslaughter. Cedric Carrier joins me now on this. So five teenagers have been found guilty of killing Keon. Cedric, what more can you tell us?
Well, Keon Lincoln was described as full of life, full of energy, with a beaming smile, according to his family. He was just 15 years old when he was shot and stabbed, just metres from his home, in the middle of a January afternoon in Birmingham. He was murdered by a group of teenagers, the youngest just 14, and said to be the gunman in an attack that lasted just 40 seconds. Four teenagers, as you say, have been convicted of murder, including the 14-year-old gunman and a 16-year-old, both of whom cannot be named because of their age. And alongside two 18-year-olds, Tajim Breckenridge and Michael Oguchukwu, both from Birmingham. Today, a fifth teenager, Kieran Donaldson, was cleared of murder but found guilty of manslaughter. He bought the weapons used in the killing, including a hunting knife that was found in the getaway car. The prosecution said five hooded individuals drove to Keon's house in a stolen car armed with knives and a loaded gun. As Keon tried to run away, they set upon him. His sister found him lying on the ground. His mother, Charmaine, heard the gunshots that killed her son before running out and fighting to try and get him conscious, but he died 2 hours later in hospital. Police still don't know why he was targeted, but this case raises serious questions, again, about how youngsters are managing to get their hands on such deadly weapons and why they are willing to use them. While Keon's mother, Charmaine, is left grieving a son, a child, killed at the hands of children.
Thank you very much, Sedgwick. A cabinet minister has admitted the government made a mistake in its handling of the events surrounding MP Owen Paterson's lobbying breach. Mr Paterson resigned yesterday following a U-turn by ministers who had originally backed him and had ordered MPs to vote for an overhaul of the system rather than supporting his suspension. Today, the Education Secretary, Nadeem Sahawi, said backtracking was the grown-up thing to do. And at least 853 migrants crossed the English Channel to the UK on small boats on Wednesday, a new record for the current crisis. The Home Office says the migrants had to be rescued or intercepted from a total of 25 incidents. Now, some change today to the advice for pregnant women when they are overdue. An NHS watchdog has U-turned on its earlier advice that a mum-to-be should be induced when they reach term at 41 weeks. The National Institute for Health and Care Excellence, known as NICE, says that women should be allowed to give birth naturally, but medics should instead give advice that carrying on after 41 weeks involves some additional risk. So let's talk more about this now. And we're joined by Dr. Marissa, as you can see, a regular on this programme. Thank you very much for joining us, Doctor. I think some women watching this might be a little bit confused, wouldn't they, about the advice, given that what happens or what they should do at 41 weeks?
Yeah, look, I think, you know, on the one hand, we welcome the fact that NICE has clearly recognised that, tragically, during this pandemic, we have seen an increase in the number of stillbirths, and that stillbirths still remain very difficult to predict and also to prevent. We know there's some very compelling reasons for needing to induce women. So if, for example, a woman has diabetes, if there are issues with the growth of her baby, if she has preeclampsia, other obstetric complications, we know that stillbirths also increase with age. But outside some of these strong indications, it's actually really difficult. We don't have enough research to tell us that all women necessarily need inducing by a certain point. And that's where it gets difficult. So what NICE has emphasized and made quite clear here is that individual discussions need to take place, and they need to take place much earlier on in a woman's pregnancy, so that she has the chance to decide alongside her partner and her family as to what is best for her. And that decision must be respected, no matter whether the healthcare professional disagrees or not. What women also need to be aware of is the fact that there are risks with inductions too. So, for example, the chance of needing an epidural, the chance of potentially needing an instrumental. And you've got to weigh that up against the risks of carrying on past 41 weeks, which is the increase in stillbirth rates and also neonatal admissions. What my personal worry with some of this is that it might be applying a bit of a band-aid over a much wider problem here, because we've also got to address the fact that we've got a huge midwife staffing crisis going on at the moment. How are we going to have the staff to potentially induce all of these extra people? Also, the fact that some partners are still not being allowed during the entire induction process. So women's mental health is being sidelined in all of this. And, you know, going through any kind of intervention is bound to increase the need for mental health services. Do we have enough provisions in terms of what we can offer women and their partners to be able to deal with that? So that's what my concern is, that I think there are some bigger issues here in terms of how we can practically allow this to happen while still keeping mothers and babies safe.
Okay, Dr. Larissa Calder, I mean, thank you very much for your comprehensive answer, and I hope women can take a lot of advice from what you've just been telling us. So thank you very much indeed for joining us this lunchtime.
Thank you. Thanks so much.
Next, we've been covering the COP26 climate summit in Glasgow all week, and today tens of thousands of young people are on the city street in protest. Fridays have long been the climate activist day of choice, and the Fridays for Future movement started, of course, by the campaigner Greta Thunberg. And Greta has made it clear she isn't impressed with what is happening on the inside of the conference. Earlier this week, she tweeted this. She said, "This is no longer a climate conference. This is a Global North Greenwash Festival, a two-week celebration of business as usual and blah, blah, blah." Now, Greta's expected to join protesters as they march through Glasgow today. Our correspondent Rachel Younger is there and sent this report a short time ago.
Good afternoon. Well, if the average age of the world leaders who addressed the COP summit just a couple of miles from here on the opening days was well over 60, it's an awful lot younger here. This is Youth Day. And although the UK Education Secretary told children to stay at school, they've had a very different approach to things here. In fact, the local authorities have told school children, they bus them in, whole schools in some cases, and they've said that this can be part of their climate education. So we're seeing enormous amounts of young people, young parents with babies on their shoulders, teenagers, students, they've all turned out here today to be a part of this march because they feel it's their chance to make a difference. They don't believe that what's happening inside COP at the moment is urgent enough, and they want to make their voices heard. Greta Thunberg due to be joining them later, and we've spoken this morning to activists from all over the world, from the Pacific Islands, from France, from Germany, and indeed from all over the UK. And in fact, I'm joined by a group of children from the SOS, from the Kids Choir, who've come from Hampshire to sing, but they also wanted to be a part of this protest today. Lane, why is it so important to be here?
Because we're tomorrow's generation and we want to help fight for our future if they're not going to.
Elizabeth, do you feel excited to be here, or do you feel worried about the messages you've been hearing?
I'm quite excited to come here, yeah.
Why did you want to get out on the streets today?
Just because the climate change has hit our planet, so we need to help it now.
Orla and Cohen, why have you come today? Why did you want to be here?
Well, I wanted to be here because I really don't want to grow up in a world with loads of fumes and stinky air and clean seas so I can swim in them.
Do you believe that the world's leaders will be watching this and will listen to you?
Actually, I don't know, because sometimes they've not stuck to their word, so they don't actually say what they're going to do, they don't keep their deals, but I think maybe they might do a few things about it, because there's a lot of people.
There really are a lot of people. The numbers are hard to estimate at the moment. Police Scotland have said that if there is any violence, any damage to property, then the action, the response will be robust and swift. But certainly at the moment, as you see the crowds going past us here, it is a family-friendly atmosphere. It is positive, it is hopeful. But most importantly of all, everybody here, as you see from the banners, are determined that this week of all weeks, their voice will be heard.
Rachel Younger on the streets of Glasgow. Next, memories of his time on our screens, our stages and on our radios are continuing to be made of entertainer Lionel Blair, whose death was announced late last night. He was 92. His career as a dancer, choreographer, actor and game show star spanned seven decades. And we can speak now to Lionel's friend and former Corrie actress, Amanda Barry. Amanda, thank you so much for joining us on the programme today. I'm sorry that it's under these circumstances, but it's really hard, as we were saying there, how to sum up his career. Someone who was an actor, was a dancer. And I think, as you tweeted yesterday, one way of doing it is to say he was laughing all the way from 1954 until 2 weeks ago.
That is the thing I shall miss most. I mean, we did laugh from about 1954 up till 2 weeks ago. And Lana made me laugh. And always, always. It was a joy. And actually, maybe that last time, about 2 weeks ago, when he rang up and said, "Amanda, I've got to tell you, I've got a new agent," which that is so Lionel that, you know, right up until the end, he was Mr. Show Business. And I've known him since 1954, and I owe him a lot because I was one of his first dancers in Scotland. And he had so much style. And he made us look so good. And we were all sort of individuals. It really helped me come out of the chorus. And then we went to Winston's together with Danny LaRue and Barbara Windsor. And then we did televisions together. But I don't think people don't make performers like him and Bruce Forsyth. It was an era of those big personalities. I mean, he did start entertaining people in bomb shelters with his sister, you know. We did say to Lionel he would perform at the opening of a fridge. You know, he was there. And, I mean, he was the epitome. He was Mr. Show Business.
He was unashamedly show business, wasn't he? I think we've got some pictures of here in the real Marigold Hotel, which he did sort of at the later stages of his life. And, I mean, he was just unashamedly showbiz, wasn't he?
Oh, he was. We thought they were going to leave us behind in a home, actually. We laughed so much in that thing, and just wanted to come home. But you can't sum up 92 years. Most of the time he was performing, I think he probably came out of the womb with tap shoes on. You cannot sum up in a few minutes except to say that Lionel was the ultimate pro, and he was Mr. Show Business and proud of it and enthusiastic right to the end. He did hope that his new agent would get the two of us a television series together.
Some people remember on our TV screens as a presenter. I suppose it depends on your generation. Others remember that he started as a dancer and became a TV star late in his latter life.
What kind of shocked me when I first saw about, you know, coming up on television, people talking about, give us a clue. I thought, my God, Lionel was a big star that nobody mentions that way before that. And dancing with Sammy Davis at that time, God, that was such a big deal. And he was a brilliant. I mean, he was a really stylish dancer.
We've loved hearing your memories today, and we really appreciate you joining us. And it was really lovely to hear some of your memories. So thank you so much for being on the Lunchtime News today.
Thank you.
Finally now, it took the Super Troopers a long time, four decades in fact, but at midnight last night, their new album was finally released. It's called Voyage, so how does it compare to their famous music of the 70s? Here's Sangeeta Kandola, who's been having a listen.
I still have faith in you. I see it now.
The Swedish foursome are hoping fans have faith in them and take a chance on their new music. 40 years after breaking up, the band are back together, bringing us one last album, aptly named Voyage, released at midnight.
We got into the studio after 39 years. It was like no time had passed.
With the combination of Frida and Agneta, that makes that unique sound. They started singing, and it was ABBA.
Critics aren't quite thanking ABBA for the music, but some say that is besides the point.
There are a few songs on this album that I don't think I ever really need to hear again. I think really, really comforting and exciting about having ABBA to come back with new music is really cheering.
The group has so far stood the test of time. They won the Eurovision Song Contest back in 1984. They went on to have 17 number one hits. Mamma Mia, here I go. The song Mamma Mia inspired a film and a musical, ensuring a new generation of fans. The group, now all in their 70s, are embracing that, following the album A One-of-a-Kind Concert next year, featuring the four as avatars, digital versions of their 1979 selves. Now the new tracks are out there, ABBA hope they hit the right note with fans and one day end up as disco dance floor classics. Sangeeta Kandola, ITV News.
Still going strong in their 70s. That's it this lunchtime. Charlene White's got the evening news at 6:30. The news where you are follows the weather, but from everyone here. Bye-bye.